to the Better Each Day podcast radio show with Bruce Hilliard. Today and every day, reaching out for innovative ideas in every way. Today's show is brought to you by your future. It comes with a lifetime guarantee.
This is the third and only member of Superband Alliance, drummer David Lauser, who has not been on the show yet. He joins Robert Berry and Gary Peel as the third and final member of Alliance to talk on the Better Each Day podcast radio show. He is a longtime member of the Sammy Hagar band. He also plays currently with future guest Greg Kinn and his band. Please welcome David Lauser.
And I like how you saved me for last because you're going to get the nitty-gritty from me. We probably should be taping this now. We're probably going to lose some good stuff.
Oh, I'm rolling right now.
You're rolling right now? Is pot legal in Washington?
Oh, yeah, it is.
I didn't know that. I'm not a pot smoker, but that was a stupid joke.
Yeah,
I know,
okay,
but
yeah.
I couldn't resist.
No, I don't have a bong, and I know what zigzags are, and yeah. I'm 63 years old, so I remember when it was like having heroin or something, you know, and the pot was crappy. It was stems and seeds, and it popped when you smoked it, and yeah.
Right on, man. We're from the same era. I have friends, or I should say I know people when I was in high school that did time.
Oh, like, yeah.
You know, it was a 5-year sentence. With good behavior, you got time off in California.
Yeah.
I mean, for having a joint, one cigarette of marijuana, not even like to where you're selling it, just possession. Is that crazy?
Yeah, I could say it was like having a heroin cartel or something. Man, this guy's got a joint. Let's get him. He's going to do time. I don't care about the pedophile that lives next door to him. We're going to get this guy.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, I've been roused. I've been pulled over a bunch when I was a kid. It was like, I grew up in San Bernardino, and the sheriff department, they were like hardcore. They were cowboys, you know. I mean it. I had a friend. In fact, I'll jump into a real quick story if you don't mind.
Sure.
A guy named Eric Fields, a great singer and guitar player. I grew up with him. He was like a year older than me in high school, but I think he flunked, so he was in my class or whatever. He was a real kind of... I guess today they'd say he was on the spectrum or whatever. It's not like he wasn't cool and couldn't communicate and perform, but he was a little bit of an oddball. Anyway, he and I, we went to school together, and he is the connection of how I met Sammy Hagar years ago when I was 17. Check it out. Now, the story I'm going to tell you is about marijuana, but I wanted to like back it up by saying Eric and I, well, I'll just tell you the marijuana thing first. Mm-hmm. We're like, you know, this is a few years later after Sam and I formed a band when we were kids and all this. He was a little older than me, much older, haha. But Eric and I were in my Volkswagen driving down the road and saying, you know, leaving a rehearsal, feeling kind of good, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
And there are the lights behind us, and it's the San Bernardino Sheriff, and my heart's just pounding. Because I know, as we say in the old days, Eric was holding.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, dude, get rid of it. Do it. Eat it.
Yeah.
So he stuck it in his mouth.
Oh,
now, the sheriff pulled us over. I had long hair. We probably smelled like pot. I don't know.
Oh, yeah.
You know, this is 1968.
Ooh. You're going to jail, young man.
Oh, dude. So I'm in this beater Volkswagen, my first car, and we get out, and I have a tanker jacket on, and in my tanker jacket, you know, is a roach clip, like those little electronic clips, you know. And this guy has got his flashlight out, he's smelling it, he's looking for residue. He goes, what's this? I go, oh, it's electronics clip. He goes, oh, yeah, right, electronics clip, you know. Cause it, you know, like, whatever, I'm a musician, so I kind of knew what you used it for anyway, but we were using it to, you know what.
Oh, sure.
So the guy frisks us. He searches the car. He frisks Eric. We get back in. I'm like, whoa, damn, dude. I'm getting nervous telling you this story right now. And we take off, and Eric starts laughing. And he pulls the joint out of his mouth, and he had it between his teeth and his upper lip. He had a big mustache. So it didn't look like it protruded, but this was a big joint. And I'm going, Eric, are you crazy? He goes, hey, man, it was a good weed. I didn't want to eat it. Oh, God, you know. Now, I got to tell you, I'm going to back Sam would probably get pissed off, but I call Sammy Sam because when we were younger and we were in bands, he was not Sammy. Mm-hmm. He became Sammy when he became a solo artist and became a star.
Yeah.
And that's what his handler was. I get it. But Sam, he turned me on to pot. I smoked my first pot with Sammy Hagar. So I'm not a drug addict or anything, by the way, nor is he.
Yeah.
In fact, we both don't really like pot that much. But Eric and I, it's a good thing you can edit this, but Eric and I are in school. I'm in my first band called Youngblood, and we go to this music store. It was like a watering hole in San Bernardino called Lear's. I used to go in there before I had a drum set and drool. And the guys, they'd always say, okay, 10 minutes, get out. You know, the store owners. But anyway, Eric comes up to me and says, hey, there's this really, there's a good band in the city, older guys that, boy, I was going to tell you the vision I just had a second ago. My fiance just got out of the shower and shut the door, and she was, what can I say, in all her glory.
Oh, my God.
I digress, dude. I'm sorry, Bruce.
Oh, no.
If she heard that, she'd kill me.
Oh, I just wish
anyway,
we had video on this.
I'm glad it is, what do you call it, FaceTime? That would have been something.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying, yeah.
But, yeah. But anyway, I'm trying to say this real quick, because this is the origin of it all. I think it's pertinent, and then you can go on with Alliance. But
yeah.
So Eric says to me, David, or Dave, you know, this band, you got to go check it out. Now, I was in my first band for a couple years, and we just started to wear each other out. We had different members, a lot of change, whatever, we were young. So I decided to check out this band, and Eric was the guitar player. That's how he got me in. So I gave notice to my first band, which was really difficult because my best friend was in it. It was like family. It was really... When you're young, that stuff is traumatic, you know. It's hard when you're older, let alone when you're 16, you know. Mm-hmm. So I joined the band. I start rehearsing, and they're like in their early 20s, 23, 22. I'm like, damn, these guys, I'm big time. I'm working with a bunch of guys in their 20s, old dudes.
Old guys,
right?
Yeah.
And I'm good, and I must be good enough, but I was humble, but a little cocky, whatever. Anyway, we were just a garage band. We called ourselves the Mobile Home Blues Band. But so Eric's older brother his name is Barry Fields. And Barry and Sam were best friends. This band had three guitar players, a big giant Mexican dude named Jesse Yamas. He was the leader. He was really good, played really loud, killed my left ear to this day. Another guy, Mike, and then Eric. Well, Eric didn't like sharing the limelight with two other guitar players, and he was really good. So he quit after a week. And Sammy shows up with Barry Fields, Eric's brother, because Barry told Sam, hey, my brother quit this band. They're pretty good. I don't know what, you know, you may want to check them out. Now, Sam was a late bloomer. He's 20, 21 years old. He shows up to rehearsal. Got on jeans, Jeff Beck chukka boots, a white t-shirt, a double-breasted white, a pinstripe suit, Fu Manchu, and a natural like Eric Clapton, and a roach clip on his collar. And I'm like, this fucking guy is cool.
Oh, yeah.
Who is this guy? I'm not kidding. I can see it today. The white t-shirt, the jeans, the chukka boots like on the Yardbirds cover. This guy, he was styling back then, and this was 1968. So I said to the leader of the band after he showed up and schmoozed us, didn't play, just watched us. I said, who is this guy? He's kind of cool looking. Is he any good? You know? And I remember Jesse, the leader, said, he can play and sing guitar. So Sam auditioned the next rehearsal. We played Sunshine of Your Love by Cream.
Oh, yeah.
And he played the solo note for note, and I was like, this is my man. And ever since then, we were like best friends. It was like, he was like my older brother I never had. It was awesome. So that's how it all began. That's how Sammy and I met. We played clubs, eventually moved to San Francisco to quote unquote make it. He met Montrose and the rest is history, right?
Yeah. So, did you ever play, Did you play with Montrose?
No, I did not. I was in a bar band with Sam called the Justice Brothers. And if I can say this about myself quickly.
Yeah.
I was really into fusion, funk, and a little jazz. And I was kind of almost like a snob. And the band was really good. We played rock and blues and R&B. We did a James Brown medley. Sam sang it. I have tapes of it. And I may one day put them out there. Who knows? Maybe I'll get sued.
That's going to be good.
We did it. We were like in San Francisco in the 70s, and disco music was starting to come in. And if you didn't play dance music, you didn't work.
Yeah.
So we played, you know, we weren't really a hard rock. We were a hard rock band before we went to San Francisco. We were playing original material and everything. But then we, you know, you relent and you want to eat and you want to work. But Sam was writing and really focused on, he wanted to be rock. And the guys in the band were really a bit more, how can I say, they were pretty savvy musicians. And, you know, Sam and I were probably the most rough-cut diamonds, as it were. Mm-hmm. Not to say that he did not ever had talent, but these other people were a little older and, like, slicker. They could play a lot of different kind of music. And Sam would present his songs. I'll never forget, he presented Bad Motor Scooter to them and a song called Make It Last off the first. And I remember thinking, nah, that's kind of cool. And the other guys are going, yeah, that's kind of weird, whatever. So he, through a mutual friend, heard that Ronnie was quitting Edgar Winter Band. This was after Frankenstein was a big hit.
Yeah.
And through a mutual friend, Sam got an audition with Ronnie, and they hooked up. And, you know, at the time, I really wasn't ready for any of that. I definitely had not much recording experience, and I definitely was on a different route. It wasn't until like a few years later I got back into rock, and then me and Sam hooked up, and then I joined this band in the 80s, you know. But no, I was not in Montrose, but the bass player, Bill Church, who was in Montrose, was in the first Hagar lineup when we did all the Geffen stuff, I Can't Drive 55 and all that, Stanley Hampton.
Yeah.
So yeah, I guess it was like half of Montrose was the Sammy Hagar band with Gary Peel on guitar, me, and Bill Church. And then we had a keyboard player. First it was Fitz, who was in Alliance. But then Fitz quit and did his own and got Night Ranger together. And then a guy named Jesse Harms came in to play keys with Sammy Hagar back in the 80s, you know, whatever. I don't know. I digress, but cut me off at any time, Bruce.
Yeah. Did you play on the recording of Can't Drive 55?
Yes.
Okay. Because I wanted to feature.
Anything Geffen. Go ahead.
Anything Geffen?
Any Geffen record that Sammy's on, except for a soundtrack for that movie with Sly Stallone, I forget what it was called, where he was like the truck driver. Danny played on that, but I played on all the Geffen stuff with Sam. And my first recording with Sammy in 1980, it was like, I'm a kind of a late bloomer, but it was the song Heavy Metal for that movie soundtrack. And, you know, that's like a mainstay, but that was the very first song we recorded. It wasn't an album. It was just that one song. And then we recorded the first full album I did with Sammy was Standing Hampton with One Way to Rock and For a Fall in Love Again, all those songs. Heavy Metal was on that too. They put that on there. But yes, no, 55. We worked that puppy up.
Ah!
I got to say, the guy really was focused on what he wanted to be and who he was. And I was just a young guy playing in a bar band, just, you know, finding my way. You know, it wasn't until a few years later that I was in a rock band called Toys, and Sam actually produced one of our demos, and he could see that I had, you know, how can I say, I sort of went full circle and was like back into rock again. I was playing the LA scene. He saw that I had chops or whatever. We were always friends. I'd call him on the road, or he'd call me, bro, I'm out here at Montrose and we're starving, you know, whatever.
Yeah. Yeah. So, as you know, I had Robert Berry on the show before, and I had Gary Peel on just recently. And
yes,
I didn't want to break this to you, but they were talking down about you. So I just wanted to know what you had to say about that.
Well, I mean, can you be more specific? I mean, were they like jealous or something?
They said that you were too good looking to be in the band, and they want to replace you with an electronic drum machine.
Aha. Uh-huh. Well, good luck. Well, okay, well, I'll tell you what, I'm not even going to defend that, okay. But I will tell you my one joke.
Okay.
Well, there's many drummer's jokes.
Oh, I know.
Drummer jokes, and here it is. I'm going to ask you a question.
Yeah.
What's the difference between a drummer and a drum machine, Bruce?
I don't know, David. What is the difference between a drummer and a drum machine?
I'm going to tell you right now. Okay. All right, hold on to your seat. Drum machine, are you ready?
Yes.
The difference between a drummer and a drum machine is pretty simple. A drum machine will keep perfect time and not hit on your girlfriend. Boom.
Okay.
Bad, huh?
Yeah, I'll add a rim shot on later on. Yeah, that's good.
Yeah, that's right. Boom. Oh, do you play?
I don't play drums, no. I'm a guitar player.
You play an instrument?
Yeah, I sing and play guitar like 4 billion other people. Yeah, yeah. I actually started when there really wasn't, it was prior to the Beatles and everything. I was listening to the Kingston Trio and, you know, Brothers Four.
Oh, whoa. Yeah, man, you've been doing it longer than me then.
I go back to the Mickey Mouse Club with Jimmy Dodd. That's when I first saw a guitar, and I thought, that looks pretty cool.
Whoa. Cubby.
Yeah.
Cubby was his first,
Cubby
on drums.
Yeah, he played with the Carpenters, I think. Cubby O'Brien.
There you go.
Yeah. Mouseketeer, right, roll call, count off
this
now.
This is cool.
Darlene, Jimmy.
I didn't start playing. I got my first kit when I was 15th birthday. I was in ninth grade.
Yeah.
That's another story. I don't want to bore you with all that. But so Robert and Gary were dissing me. I know that's bull right there.
It's entire bullshit.
Really jive.
They love you.
That's some BS.
I don't think you'd call the band Alliance if you guys didn't get along.
No. I tell you, this band, I will say, I'll jump around a little bit. You hold down the fort, but I will say, I've been recording and touring with Sammy off and on, you know, on big time since 1980. What is that? 30, good God, how many years is that? Let's do the math. Is that 29 years?
It's going to be 40 in a year. 39.
Yeah, there you go. Well, anyway, the point is like, love Sam. We have a great rapport. It wasn't a necessarily a Democratic band. It was the Sammy Hagar band. He's the star. He's the leader.
Mm.
But he really gave me leeway creatively. 55, that was my own beat. I came up with all, I mean, you know, we came up with our own parts. The producer didn't spoon feed us. But I'll say this, having said that, Alliance probably gives me more, regardless of what Gary and Robert say, they give me more freedom of creativity than I've ever had with any act I've ever played with. You know, I'm not kidding. I've actually gotten a couple songs that I wrote on these records. So that's just fun in itself. But Robert is a consummate musician. He plays everything. I get sick of saying this because I know I don't want his head getting big, but guy's classically trained pianist.
Yeah.
Plays great guitar. So he's played bass with Keith Emerson and Carl Palmer. Okay, duh, enough said.
Yeah.
Plays drums pretty good. I ain't gonna give him too much on that.
Yeah.
That punk.
Yeah.
And sings, writes, he's the engineer, produces a lot of acts in the Bay Area. Has a studio. I mean, he's a crack engineer. He's really good. It makes it a pleasure recording with him. He gets great sounds. I have to help him a little bit, but anyway.
Yeah.
And then Gary is just like automatic. you know, it's like Gary was born, he has that innate ability. You play him a song, his solos, he just really, he's just one of those naturals. You know, if he was that good years ago, he hasn't really gotten any better. He was just really good 30 years ago, you know. Me, I've grown. But anyway, I love those guys, and they really, we produced, to give you an idea, any musicians out there, we produced this as a band. You know what I mean? In other words, we all three had our input on the way the arrangements were. And you know, that to me is a high compliment, because I will go back to Robert, as talented and versatile as he is, for him to actually listen to me and not put the drum machine on, my God, you know?
Yeah. The drum machine that doesn't hit on your girlfriend. Yeah, he's a wonderful guy to talk to, very personable. And he had some stories about what it was like working with Emerson and Palmer. Fascinating. You guys have all played with really top-notch musicians. That's so cool. And you must pinch yourself every now and then. But I don't know, you're probably just used to it. And unless you're talking to somebody like me, it's just another day to you, you know. I just think it's the coolest thing ever, you know. Here's my story. I quit and went into corporate America, and then I came back and when I was about 60 and said, you know what, that sucked. It was as fraudulent as anything I've seen, as bad of things as they say about musicians, especially rock musicians. The most honest people I ever worked with. Yeah, you can have the Fortune 500 guys. I don't trust them. I'd rather play in a rock band any day.
Yeah.
So there.
Well, you know, I'll be the devil's advocate here. There's bad seeds in every bat. I've met some musicians in my life that were really problematic and egotistical or whatever, but majority of people, I mean, it's a brotherhood for sure. Mm-hmm. You know, there's definitely a sister brotherhood with people that play. There's a drummer named Bill Ward who played with, God, I'm blanking right now. She's a really sexy. She had that song. I mean, she played with the Grateful Dead sometimes. She had that song, If God Was One of Us. What's her name? Come on, you know it.
Alanis Morissette.
I'm not going to say that. Yeah. Anyway, this drummer played with a lot of people, and he did a modern drummer presentation. And one of the things he said about musicians, he said, musicians are, you know, I call people that aren't musicians civilians. I thought that was kind of cool. In other words, it's like the Marine Corps, right? You know, Semper Fi, you know, for life. So I'll tell you something, Bruce. Now you're pretty close to my age, and I will say, to this day, you talk about pinching yourself. I'm looking at a drum set right now, and I'm talking to you. Beautiful DW kit in my office. I still pinch myself to go, you saw Beatles on Ed Sullivan, you weren't playing an instrument, something clicked, and a few years later, you were playing in a band. I still don't quite believe it. And I've been on the road, I've been to every state in the United States like 30 times. You know, I've made records, I feel so blessed. And it's true what they say, it's luck, talent, and the right time, right place, all that kind of stuff. You know, but I'm still like a kid. I can look at a snare drum and want to sleep with it. You know?
Yeah, that's good. Yeah, practice your ass off and play thousands of hours, and then when that spark of luck hits, you're ready, I think. And and if you're not, you might not get it again. So, yeah, you did it all right. Yeah. Back to the songs. Here are the songs that I featured on Gary's episode, Fire and Grace and Time.
Well, one reason I like talking about, it's funny you picked that, because first of all, Time, I would say I like a lot of the material, a lot of it, but Time, for some reason, resonated with me. The lyric, the vibe of the song, it's probably my favorite song on the record, even though there's more rockin' tunes. Mm. I think I love Time. And Time is one of the first songs, I mean, this album took about 10 years to make, because we were all in different bands doing different stuff. And Robert would send me a demo of a song with the drum machine or him playing or whatever. And then we'd get together in a studio, and I'd lay down a drum track. And Time was, I think it was one of the first songs I recorded for this record. I want to say it was in 2010. My God.
Jeez.
I know I wrote Good Life. I brought Good Life, Living a Good Life, to Robert in 2010-ish. And then he co-wrote it with me. We wrote that song together, which was really a pleasure. Fire and Grace, which at the time, I didn't know what it was going to be called, but Gary may have said this, but Gary had the riff. And we went in the studio together while Robert was engineering it, you know, just the two of us, and Robert was recording us, because that's how we do this. And we really, no exaggeration, we did it in one take. It was just like a jam. And during the song, there's breaks in it, like dan, 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 but they're all different. They're all a little different. And I was having eye contact with Gary and making shit up on the spot. We're literally just having fun messing with him. Some of the stuff he caught, some of it he screwed up. And then after we cut it, one take, he went back and fixed the things that to match him with me. You know how, you know, he overdubbed it. Mm-hmm. But really, that song from the beginning, except for the arpeggio guitar on the intro, the music of that song was done in one take with two guys in the studio. It was totally on the fly. How do you say? Not spontaneous, but...
That'll work.
Oh, I can't even think of it.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
He described it just the way you did.
Oh, that... That rat, he beat me to the punch. Well, then, you know, it's kind of like when detectives separate the two defendants.
Exactly.
We know our stories are matching, you know.
Yeah.
So I'm glad, because I prepped Gary for that. I said, whatever you do, tell him we did it one
Well,
take,
that's what my show's all about. I like to do this really in-depth interviews so I can embarrass people and get into dirty laundry and ask if you ever cheated on
Yeah. I can dig it. Well, the thing is now they wrote the lyrics for that after the fact. I don't know how much of the lyrics are written. So we literally recorded that song. I'm going to say, I'm shooting from the hip. I'm saying 8 years ago, 7 years ago. And then while we got together this last year in December or whatever it was, right before in 2019, we finished the record. We actually recorded two or three or four new songs. We had like 20 songs to pick from because it's been 10 years, right? We finished Fire and Grace. Like, the song was actually, it's weird that actually the music was done and they actually completed the lyric on it like 6 months ago, you know, like in December. So it was kind of, I was blown away that we were listening to playbacks to stuff that had been done almost 10 years prior.
Wow.
And it was relevant and felt like what we just did a week ago.
Oh, yeah.
That song to me is really a good rock tune. It's not, ain't a whole lot of like, you know, like Robert's really more progressive than me or Gary. Gary can play anything, but Robert, come on, he played with Keith Emerson. Mm. I'm more meat and potatoes. You know what I mean? I have chops, but I'm not like a flash drummer.
I disagree. I would say you fit right in with the prog type deal, I think, totally.
Well, Robert stretched me out. I've never been, you know, the most progressive stuff I did with Sammy was like stuff like Three Lock Box, where there's like a bar of three or it's in 5/8. Like there's some stuff that if you write it out, it's odd time, but we just felt it. But with Robert, there's sometimes I'm playing in 7 or 5 and it feels good. A lot of times I just play 4/5 or 4/7 and it works, mm-hmm. you know? So that's kind of neat, but I appreciate what you're saying because that's an area that's a little foreign to me. I mean, like, I like Rush and stuff like that, but that isn't like that's not my territory, you know?
You mentioned Sunshine of Your Love when you were just learning. That was kind of a different beat, actually. It could be played in 4, but it doesn't sound like it's in 4.
Well, I don't want to bore listeners, but yeah, the drums are halftime. Like during the verse, he's playing halftime with the snare on 1 and 3 instead of 2 and 4. Bap, boom, 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 bap, boom, boom, boom. And then when it goes to the chords, boom, bap, boom, boom, bap. You know, it's like backwards.
Yeah.
So, yeah, you're right. That's a really cool song. And I'll tell you a little tidbit. I'm jumping around the tee kicked in, but Sam and I, after we were in Mobile Home, that fell apart. I was too young to play in bars. Then when I got my brother's fake ID, my older brother had a learner, or a temporary license, so it didn't have a picture on it.
Yeah.
So anyway, Sam and I were in this band called The Big Bang. He was on to Outer Spaceship back then. But we played at a Battle of the Bands. This is like a couple years after we met. Before we were the Justice Brothers, we played at the Battle of the Bands, and we played Manic Depression by Jimi Hendrix,
oh, yeah.
And we won the fucking Battle of the Bands with that song. That's pretty progressive, though,
yeah.
That song.
Yeah, yeah.
So we were a trio, and we played Manic Depression, and what we got for doing it, they gave us a Fox white teardrop guitar.
Oh.
And a trophy, you know. So we took that trophy, we took that guitar down to Lear's Music, and we traded it in for some PA speakers.
Well, that's cool. Yeah, that guitar is like Rolling Stones had one, I think.
Exactly, yeah. Brian Jones. Yep, you know, yep. See, are people following this? Or are listening as old as us?
Yeah, probably not.
I'm torn. I'm going to pump my own steam here, whatever that means. But like, living a good life. I brought that to the band, and Robert and I wrote it. He really came to want to bat and came up with a great bridge, and we did the lyrics together. He really helped me with that. I mean, that's really a collaboration. I'm so proud of that. And then Fire and Grace was a group effort, which is always kind of cool to have a song that the whole band kind of composed. And then, I mean, we all have input, but you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But now there's a song called The Real Thing. And I'm going to put this on here because I want to give out some love to my fiance, if I can get cheesy or whatever.
You can just get
it. I met this woman 4 years ago. We had today is our first anniversary of our first date today, mm-hmm. the 20th of June. I don't know when the broadcast is, but that's it. So the short of it is this. I was my first marriage. I was young. We're still friends. We had a beautiful daughter together. We divorced. All good. My second marriage went on for a while. It was good. We were best friends, soulmates. She passed away.
Mm.
I didn't think I'd ever meet another person. This is like 4 years ago. I'm no spring chicken like you.
Mm-hmm.
And anyway, I met Julie at a high school reunion just by fluke, like one of those last minute things. And it's freaky. I don't know if you... there's always movies like this, like they go back in time. Had you not walked down the street and turned a corner and picked up that stone or whatever,
yeah,
you know, it just blows my mind how life, the twists and turns. Anyway, so The Real Thing was inspired by me meeting this woman and like just saying, damn, she's the real thing. It's like on all levels. I won't get too graphic, but you know.
Well, she just got in the shower, didn't she?
Yeah, she rocks my world. So I wrote that complete, all the lyrics myself. You know, I've written songs before. I don't think I've ever written a song where I wrote all the changes in the lyrics and the band just played it. Wow. So I'm really proud of that, and I'm so happy it made the record. But that's kind of my little story behind that, because the woman I met is the real deal, and I'm, what can I say, I'm crazy about her.
Until she made me see.
That's for the women folk out there, you know?
Okay. I've got this theory, and I'll definitely feature the song. Now I have to, because she'll slap you around or something. No, she wouldn't. But anyway, the most important thing I think you really have in your life when you're coming down the home stretch, or you have a week to live, and you think about all the things, it's not all the material stuff at all. It's the relationships that you have, I think.
Amen, brother. Amen. This is it, you know. I feel blessed. I mean, like I'm blessed as a musician. You know, I still pinch myself, you know. I don't know. I mean, like, I don't know how much I can talk about this, but, you know, we're talking about Sammy and me and Gary. You know, Robert and I and Sammy actually played together in Mexico at one of the Los Tres Cusanos incarnations, which is me, Michael Anthony, and Sammy. When Sammy was still in Van Halen, mm-hmm. we'd go down to Cabo San Lucas in the off time, and that was a jam band. Well, it turned into the Birthday Bash. I don't know if you're hip to that or not.
Tell me what that is. I might know. Now,
okay, Sam's birthday is October 13th,
yeah.
and he owns the Cabo Wabo
right.
Club. It was a Van Halen club. They kind of like went, after a while, the sheen wore off. And so Sam bought them out. So now it's like a destination. Cabo San Lucas, when Sammy and Van Halen started that club back in 1991 or whatever, not a lot of people were hip to Cabo. You know, it was like the main thing that people knew about Cabo was that in October they'd have like those marlin fishing tournaments. It's like on the Cape, so it's really famous for like sports fishing. However, when I first went back there down there in the early 90s, there was like two hotels. Now it's like Las Vegas. There's like 40 hotels. All the beaches are built up. They got McDonald's and Sam's Club and Costco. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
It's like so Americanized, which is cool in some ways, but whatever. But it's like an Easter break stop, you know? So the point is that in the old days, not very many people knew about it, and so it was like a place where musicians could go and just chill and jam and get away with whatever they wanted to get away with, you know. So Sam decided that every October he would like have, I think the first one was 1993 or 4, I forget. So we'd have the Birthday Bash, which we'd play odd nights, like 9, 11, 13, and then we'd recoup the days off, you know. So that's happening again this year. Sam will be 72.
No way.
And it's going to be a Wabos reunion. So me, Mona, Vic, and Sam are playing that. Not that I want to pump that right now, talk about Alliance, but I thought I'd mention that because it's kind of a big deal. He's been doing like his circle band called The Circle with Mikey and Jason Bonham. So I don't know. Maybe Gary and Robert will come down and jam with us. You never know.
That'd be the coolest thing ever. Wow. Yeah, I'm glad you talked.
And they have.
Yeah, I'm glad you covered all the stuff that you did. I can chop this all up and make it really good. So,
Good God, thank God, because I'm all over the map. I apologize.
No, you're not. I am too. Well, I'm drinking coffee here, so yeah.
I'm a tea guy. I've had coffee in my life, but for some reason I can drink tea and not get too jacked.
Enjoyed your time. We're almost 45 minutes here, but I'll chop it into...
Well, hey, you're in control, Mr. Hilliard.
Yeah.
When you want to pull the plug, let me know. I'll long jaw your ass, you know.
Well, that's interesting that you found a woman at your age, because I haven't been with a woman in 3 years. Probably. I'm a monk. I might as well be a virgin.
Well,
yeah.
It's weird, brother. Here's the thing. I grew up in San Bernardino. Well, I grew up back east, moved to San Bernardino with my parents when I was like 12. And then I left for the Bay Area when I, you know, with Sammy and everything, and was up in the Bay Area in San Francisco for my whole life, my adult life. And then I moved back down here when my wife died. We had a place in Palm Desert, which is about an hour away from San Bernardino. And I got this email about, hey, there's going to be a reunion. Now, I didn't know my fiance. She's a little bit younger than me, 4 years or whatever. But you know how it is. It's like, as you get older with reunions, they invite all the schools. So all the schools in the area. Otherwise, if you just had one high school reunion with people in their 60s,
but
three people show up.
I know, in a wheelchair.
yeah, whatever. Yeah. So she was there. I didn't know her, but she knew some of the people I knew, and we met. And, she actually introduced herself to me. The story is that she looked at me and went, hey, this guy's kind of cute. I'm going to, not be afraid, and I'm going to go up to him. She goes, hey, I heard you went to Harrowview Junior High School. I'm like, I looked at her. This is no bullshit. You may want to save this. I don't know.
Yeah.
I looked at her because I'm looking at her going, okay, she doesn't look, she's well-preserved. In other words, she doesn't look her age. Mm-hmm. And she's saying, I go, no, you can't have gone. You didn't graduate when I did. She goes, well, I graduated in 72 or whatever. I go, okay. But before she told me that, I looked at her, and this is what came out of my mouth. I said, have you had work done?
Oh, Jesus. Okay.
And she cracked up. So the fact that she laughed and went, no. But I said, oh, my God, I'm sorry. I have Tourette's. I said, that's a compliment. I mean that as a compliment. I go, but you do not look like you graduated with my ass. So I'm not. That is a true story, brother. I swear to God. Anyway, I'll leave you with that. Don't give up. If you put your heart and soul out there, I went on that. What do you call it? The Match.com and all that crap. It was depressing. I had to get off of it.
I can't do
as
that.
As soon as I get off of it,
I can't bring myself to doing that for some reason. I don't know.
I did it, dude. I did it for two. There's my dude for you. My one dude.
Okay, dude.
I did it for 2 weeks, and I looked at these women, and I was like, oh, my God, what am I doing? It actually depressed me, and I pulled the plug. I went, I took my thing off there. Because you're afraid to be yourself. You're trying to find that good picture, and they ask you all these stupid, well, whatever.
Yeah, I know.
Looking back on it, I should have said, look, I don't give a shit what people think. Here's who I am. If anybody out there thinks I'm cool in any way, give me a call.
Yeah.
I didn't have the courage at that time, whatever.
Yeah, here's my criteria for a woman. If she laughs at my jokes, she's in. That's all I need right there.
Oh. That's funny you say that, because my woman, her whole thing was, the first thing was like, you make me laugh.
Yeah.
You have a sense of humor. She was like, we laugh a lot. And she puts up with my crazy ass,
We'll start now with that. Did you have work done?
Oh, dude.
I've heard of pickup lines. That's not one of them.
Oh, it's classic, man. Enough about that.
Okay.
So, pleasure speaking with you. And I really think, I really am proud of this record. There's a lot of good material on it. And I'm happy with the way we played. And, frankly, I feel honored to be playing with these guys. So I'll give them that much. They kind of punked out on me with their smart-ass remarks, but I feel honored.
I entirely fabricated all of that. They love you. You guys are great.
Oh, I know. I know. I know. They give me so much leeway. I'm like, really? You want to hear what I have to say? Okay, shut up and listen.
Well, you're a drummer and all that crap, so well.
Exactly.
Thanks for your time, David.
You too. I maybe one of these days we'll bump into each other.
I hope so.
All right. Take care, brother.
been listening to the Better Each Day podcast radio show with Bruce Hilliard. We'll be back with a new horizon, but until then, honor the future. It comes with a lifetime guarantee.
We're all just trying to make the next day a bit better.